And I found the Easter Hallelujah. So here you go. A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before it. Hallelujah! 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 He hung his head and prepared to die, then lifted his face up to the sky, said, "I am coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul the glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The soldier who had used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord said, "Truly this is Jesus Christ, our Savior." He looked with fear upon his sword, then turned to face his Christ the Lord, fell to his knees, crying, "Hallelujah! Hallelujah! 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 Hallelujah!" Took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown and laid him down to rest beside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet and side, now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves. Oh, hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. 3 days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice anointing. Hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, but Jesus Christ has risen. Hallelujah! 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 Hallelujah!
Thank you both for that beautiful prelude this morning. As we come to worship our Lord, let us open with prayer. Journey with us, we pray, O holy God, as we continue our way to the cross. Sharpen our focus, that our attention may center more on you than ourselves. Lead us through the shadows of darkness, and prepare our hearts that we might be a people of prayer, ready to perceive and respond to your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. in whose most holy name we pray. Amen. Join me in the call to worship printed in our bulletin this morning. Let us worship God who has done great things.
We rejoice in our God who made a way through the desert of this world.
Let us worship God who has caused streams of mercy to flow in the wasteland.
We are the people God has formed through Christ. We worship Him and we rejoice.
Let us worship God in spirit and in truth.
We praise God who the grace that has saved us. Hallelujah. We rejoice.
Grace and peace to you from our holy God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning, our hymn of praise, is number 352, Blessed Be the Name. Please stand if you're able. Be seated. Thank you. Join me in our responsive reading this morning, which is the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures.
He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul.
He leads me by the path for the remaining faith.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Amen. Isaiah prophesied these words of God. For a brief moment, I abandoned you, but with great compassion, I will gather you. In overflowing wrath, for a moment, I hid my face from you. But with everlasting love, I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. Let us confess our sins to our loving God. Almighty God, you despise nothing you have made, and you forgive the sons and all who are penitent. Create in us new and contrite hearts, that truly repenting of our sins, and acknowledging our brokenness, we may obtain from you, the God of all mercy, full pardon and forgiveness, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Words of assurance. Those who love me I will deliver, says the Lord. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them and show them my salvation. Receive the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of the sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Remain standing if you can as we sing our next hymn, number 260, and Can It Be That I Should Gain? Mm-hmm. Trying, but the message is so true. How can it be that I should gain? We do need more practice. We'll try that one again. And keep the lyrics in mind as we go to Scripture and to the Word. As we prepare to do that, let us pray together for illumination. Guide us, O God, by your word and spirit, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover your peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The scripture readings today are from the book of Acts, the 4th chapter, verses 8 through 10, and from the Gospel of John, chapter 9, verses 1 through 39. Hear the word of the Lord. Just stand kind of close. Yeah. Right there.
Okay. Reading from Acts. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed." Reading from John. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes. Then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight, and they asked them, "Is this your son, who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son, and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age. Ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me, so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." This is the word of the Lord.
And many thanks to Kathy, who volunteered to read scripture today, and just by the luck of the draw, it ended up being the longest lectionary scripture that we ever read. Thanks, Kathy. Yeah, you would think. She was. Please pray with me. Oh, Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We have a future musician in our midst here, I see. Someone that wants to play your guitar, Jerry. The first scripture read this morning started like this. It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. From the fourth chapter of the book of Acts. These are the words spoken by the Apostle Peter, as he and the Apostle John were brought before the Sanhedrin in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. After Jesus's death and resurrection, but before his ascension to heaven, Jesus had told the apostles to stay in Jerusalem until the day of Pentecost. And on that same day, as Peter was giving his longest recorded speech in the Bible, Luke records this. He tells us that the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, so the number of people grew by the thousands. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so was Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name did you do this? Peter answers boldly, telling the crowd surrounding him and John, a crowd that's made up of elders and priests and lawmakers, teachers. Peter tells all these higher-ups that because of the man that they condemned to be nailed to the cross and buried in a tomb, but the man whom God raised from the dead and brought home to glory at God's right hand, it is because of that very man that Peter and John were able to, in the name of Jesus, heal that man. The Gospel of John tells us the good news that this statement that Peter made about a man being healed. Oh, a little healing. I think that healing's the kind that takes a kiss from mama. John does tell us the good news that this statement that Peter made about a man being healed because of the holy name of Jesus is true for all of us. Human beings do crucify each other at times. Perhaps not in the sense of nailing a man to the cross, but in so many other ways, it is in our human nature since the fall of the first man and woman to condemn each other for our sins, for our faults, even for our differences. We tend to tear each other down when God wants to welcome us and hear our confession and give us comfort and raise us up into God's glory. We want to place blame on other people or things. Men crucify. God rectifies. The story from the Gospel of John, that very lengthy story, gives an example of men jumping to condemnation. Who is to blame for this man's blindness? Him? His parents? But Jesus looked at the situation from a completely different perspective. The question of sin didn't even figure into the equation. We all sin, but we aren't all born blind. One had nothing to do with the other. But all of the men witnessing the event, from the disciples first asking the questions of Jesus, why is this man blind, to the Pharisees questioning Jesus' healing on the Sabbath, humans in this story were all accusing, pointing fingers, trying to place blame. But Jesus says, this man's blindness is to be used for God's glory. Imagine that. One man's suffering was to be used for God's glory. And it is through the miracle of bringing sight to this man who was just sitting by the side of the road trying to survive that God's glory would be revealed. Similar stories of sight being given to the blind are told in the Gospels of Matthew and Mark. So what makes this story different in the Gospel of John? Why are such similar stories told in two or three or even all four of the Gospels? And why are so many of the stories told by Mark, Matthew, and Luke not included in the Gospel of John? Theologians have studied such questions for centuries with all sorts of complex answers. Boiled down to the basics, scholars might say the differences in the four Gospels reflect each author's community and historical context in which they wrote. For example, Mark was written at a time when Christians were being persecuted in Rome. Mark focuses on the idea that Jesus was a persecuted servant, encouraging Christians throughout Rome that despite being persecuted as they were for their faith, they could take up the cross of Jesus and follow him, for the good news of the gospel would save them in the end. While Mark's audience would have been the Gentile Christian community, Matthew's audience was the Jewish Christian community. Matthew focused on Jesus as the promised Messiah of the Jewish people, the King of the Jews, the teachers of the new law, calling people to be faithful to the covenant with God. Matthew is intent on showing his audience that Jesus is the one true Messiah promised in Scripture. Luke wrote about the Jesus who was a merciful, compassionate, prayerful teacher with a special concern for women, the poor, and for non-Jews. He is known to be an accurate historian who researched everything as best he could. Luke spends the first two chapters on the birth and youth of Jesus. John does not include Jesus' human birth at all. Luke also talks about Jesus' human emotions and his other human traits. The fact that he mourned, that he was tempted by the devil, that he got hungry, and that he was brought to salvation by, strengthened by angels that came to help him. His human qualities that Luke focused on. While 90% of the Gospel of Mark is contained in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, John's Gospel contains only about 10% of the same writings that are common in the other Gospels, even though all of the other Gospels were written before John. It's likely that John wrote his Gospel story at the end of the first century. He wrote as an old man, with the perspective of a lifetime of experience walking with Jesus. We know several details about John's life based both on the Bible and other historical documents. John was born in Bethsaida in Galilee sometime around the year 10. I've read everything from 6 to 11, so I settled on 10. The son of Zebedee and Salome. He was also the brother of James. We know that John had been a follower of John the Baptist, and then he became one of the first disciples called by Jesus to follow him. Jesus was fishing with his family on the Sea of Galilee when Jesus called him to be a disciple. John traveled with Jesus for his entire public ministry, eating, sleeping, praying, conversing, sharing intimate stories with his friend, Jesus. John was a member of the inner circle, often accompanying Jesus when others were not there. John was among the witnesses at the foot of the cross. Based on how old he was, when we know he was born, John was probably only about 14 to 16 years old when he witnessed the brutal crucifixion of his dear friend and mentor. Imagine that. John was among the witnesses at the cross with a few others. And it was at the foot of the cross that Jesus said to John, "I want you to take care of my mother." Now, Jesus had a brother, James. Why was James not going to take care of their mother, Mary? We don't know. Maybe even then there was such family discord that the end of a life was difficult in the family situation. Happens to all of us. Regardless of why Mary wasn't commanded to the care of James, and James asked to care for his mother for the rest of his life, we don't know that, but we do know that Jesus asked John, this very young man, perhaps just a teenager, to take care of Mary. And he did. Later, John clearly continued his mission as a disciple of Christ. And we often hear, as we did this morning from Acts, that Peter and John were often together. Perhaps Peter took over the older mentor role for John when Jesus died. But Peter and John had very different personalities. Peter spoke bluntly and was often portrayed in the forefront of verbal disputes or even physical disputes. John, on the other hand, always stayed in the shadow. He was the one walking behind when Jesus was telling Peter how the end of his life would come. And Peter says, well, what about him? John following them. How long is he going to live? How is he going to die? And Jesus says, basically, it's none of your concern. That man will live as long as I want him to live. But imagine, at that time, an average lifespan, if a person lived past infancy, which certainly brought down the average lifespan, but the average lifespan, I read, was only 35 to 40 years old. Who in here is under 40? There's a few over here. John lived into his 90s. Imagine. I can put Bob in this class now because I know he. Imagine Bob and Elwood sitting here. And the only other people in these pews are over here. The rest of us perhaps didn't survive past 40 years old. That's how life was until the Middle Ages and even beyond, as medical awareness took hold and longevity increased. But the point is that John was granted a long life. Why? based on what we read in the story from John, I would say it was for the glory of God. Why does God do things? Why does Jesus, as God, do particular things? Why are we put here? To the glory of God. It doesn't matter if we're blind or lame. God uses us to his glory. I always imagined John as a young man fishing by the sea. I did. Or I imagined John in the temple at Jerusalem, in the bustling city. I never really imagined John as an old man walking the streets of Ephesus, where I know Bob and Linda have been, and I've been watching a program about Ephesus, and it just really opened my imagination to what John was like when he wrote this gospel. He was an old man who had the perspective of age and all of the things that he saw Jesus do, the miracles he worked. But more than that, John's emphasis was always on the divinity of God. John never mentions himself by name in the gospel that bears his name. He calls himself the one whom Jesus loved, or the beloved apostle. Is that egotistical of him? No. We should all be able to refer to ourselves as the beloved of Jesus. I am the one who Jesus loved. Each and every one of us wants to be able to say that. Jesus wants us to say, I am the one whom Jesus loved. The other gospel writers, as I said, all used parables to teach, used parables as ways that Jesus taught those following him. John took a different approach. John shows Jesus' life as a living parable. John said, I am the light of the world. And in the next chapter, the one we read from today, Jesus opens the eyes of a blind man so that he might see the light that is Christ. In every situation, with the woman at the well, Jesus is thirsty. She has the container with which to give him water. And he tells her, I am the living water. When Jesus fed the masses, the other gospels focus on the miraculous act of increasing the loaves and fishes. John focuses on the fact that Jesus is the bread of life. At the end of that story in John, there's only enough collected in a couple of baskets left over to meet the needs of the disciples. Everyone has been fed to their fill, and now there's enough left. Enough. That's what God gives us, enough to meet our daily needs. John does not focus on the miracle of this great abundance. John focuses on God's provision for us in every way that we need it. Whether we are sinners or not, well, we are sinners. There is no or not. But God looks past those sins when we confess to him. He gives us new life every day as we come to him. If we look at Jesus' life as a living parable, then our goal should be to live our lives as a living parable to others. Rather than condemning and crucifying, can we lift up and heal? God used all of the authors of the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The people that wrote them, whether they were actual human beings or groups of people, all of that varies depending on what you study, except for John. John is said to be the author of the Gospel of John. But God was able to use every single one of those very diverse people in their diverse cultures, in the diverse audiences that they speak to. God used every single one of them to his glory. It's what God wants to use us, each and every individual one of us, with our faults and flaws and diversities. God has a way to use us. If there's one activity, I guess, I might suggest for Lent, it would be to listen to the Gospel of John. Whether you want someone to read it to you, I'll come and read the Gospel of John to you if you'd like. But what I did was go to YouTube, and there is a common English version of the Gospels that's read. Has a little bit of dramatization behind it, so you're not just listening to someone read, but it really brings home the story of the gospel when you listen to it from beginning to end. If anyone's interested in a link to listening in that manner, I'd be happy to provide it to you. But if there is one thing that you might choose to do for Lent this year, it would be my suggestion that you listen to the Gospel of John from beginning to end. And in so doing, I think that sense of this old man who lived so much of his life walking with Jesus knew clearly and certainly that he, Jesus, is the Messiah, the one who died to forgive our sins, that we might all bring glory to our God. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you speak to us in plain English, in words that we can understand, to know that there is no condemnation in you for those who love you and turn to you, who seek to obey your commands. Lord, help us to live our lives as living parables, examples to others of your teaching. We pray, Lord, for your help in doing this. We pray all of this in the perfect name of Jesus. Amen. As we have heard the word of our Lord and have been given such a bountiful offering of blessings from him, now as the deacons come forward, we'll take the morning offering. Thank you. We bring you these gifts, O God, from what we have first received from you. Use them, we pray, to enable the ministries of this church to flourish as we together serve our neighbors both near and far away by showing love and doing mercy in your name. Amen. Let us pray together. Maker of heaven and earth, you are our help. We lift our eyes to you. As we walk this Lenten journey, you watch over our coming and our going, both now and forevermore. You are our shade and our protection. You keep us from all harm. We ask that you strengthen and guide us as we do your work in your world. Convict us of our disobedience and enable us to obey your call in our lives. Open our ears to the cry of the poor. Teach us to seek and to do justice, to stay in the path of understanding, to pursue righteousness and love in the strong name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, you know the anguish of our human lives. You have heard the names of those for whom we've offered prayers this morning. Lord, we turn to you now in the silence of our hearts to pray for those most personal and intimate concerns. Lord, as one who sees the pain of those who suffer, bring comfort, peace, and strength. As one who has experienced the agony and tears of losing loved ones, comfort all who grieve. As one who wept over the faithlessness of your people, send your Spirit to correct us in our own unfaithfulness. As one who understands the agony of those who have been deserted, stand alongside those who feel alone and abandoned today. As one who was once forsaken by all others, give hope and assurance to those who feel rejection. As one who knows the ravages of violence, bring peace and healing to those who are tortured by enemies. You, O Lord, have offered up prayers with loud cries and tears. Hear us when we do the same. We approach your throne of grace with boldness. May we receive mercy and grace in our time of need. Lord, you bring us together as your people, as children whom have been taught by the Lord to pray to our Holy Father, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn today is number 259, Are You Washed in the Blood?
Now receive the benediction.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.